You probably know a little about the Apollo missions to the moon, and chances are that at some point in your life you have heard the famous one small step transmission. The Apollo missions were a grand achievement for NASA, and 50 years on, the significance of those historical accomplishments is still with us. But how did we get to the moon? How did we overcome the knowledge gap that existed prior to the space race of the 50s, 60s, and 70s? Hey guys, I'm Grant from Active Galactic Videos. While I was looking into this question, I came across a program I had never heard of before, Surveyor. As it turns out, the University of Arizona has the perfect place to learn more about it, so I came to the Space Imagery Center to find out more.
I'm Todd Anderson, and my current title is Imaging Specialist for the University of Arizona and for the Lunar and Planetary Laboratory.
I started by asking John some rather basic questions. Why Surveyor? How did the rush to the moon begin? What is the context for the missions? This is what he told me.
President Kennedy, in his inaugural address, put the challenge out to the American people of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth by the end of the decade. So that started the race. And I've learned since I've been here that the University of Arizona had a big part in a lot of that science. Well, before you could send somebody to the moon, you gotta know what it's made of. They weren't sure that it wasn't green cheese, you know, at the time. And, you know, I gotta find that amazing. They knew from telescopic observation that it was a rocky body, but that's really all they knew. Surveyor was designed with three primary mission objectives. The first objective was, can we land something on the moon? Nobody had ever tried. Everything they'd set up had been crash landed. So the first objective was, well, to get there and land on the moon. The second objective was to find out what the surface of the moon is. Will it support weight? Various scientists had theorized that it was just a pile of dust, and that if you tried to land anything on the moon, it would sink in and disappear. Other people said, no, if you try to land anything on there, it'll bounce off. Part of it was to send pictures back so we knew what we were looking at, so we could get an idea of the surface terrain. If we sent people up there, what would they find when they got there? What did they need to do to walk on the moon, to get samples from the moon, to explore the moon? Surveyor also was designed to, by sending back pictures, send back color pictures, monochrome pictures, and also to send back survey pictures where, instead of using color filters, they use polarizing light filters to determine the composition of the moon. They also had other instruments. They had a little digger that would go out and dig trenches in the moon so they could figure out what the density of the surface was. They had what's called an alpha scattering instrument to read the chemical composition of the moon. So it was pretty complex an undertaking. And the idea that they wanted to find out, well, if we send a man up there, or send men up there, will they be able to do anything once they get there? Will they be able to walk on the moon? Can we bring samples back? You know, we didn't know before Surveyor really what the moon was made out of.
It turns out the Surveyor landers were equipped with a lot of different sensors used to gather information. From alpha particle scattering devices to magnetic detectors, they packed a variety of instruments used to help NASA learn what they needed to know.
The high points really was the astounding success of Surveyor. There were a total of 7 craft that were launched. 5 of the 7 made it and worked. They lost 2, Surveyor 2 and Surveyor 4, mid-course. One of them lost its rear motors, the other one lost communications. But the amount of information that we gained was far and away above what they even had hoped to obtain. 87,000 images of the moon, and of the planets, and of the Earth, and of the surrounding solar system, not being there at the time. But I certainly get the feeling that they were amazed at how well it worked and how much information they did get from the moon. And looking at it now with 21st century eyes, back in the 60s, I was just in college, and watching NASA presentations and watching the live shots from the moon as a broadcast engineer, was like, wow, that's really cool stuff, you know. And now I'm looking at the technology, and I'm still saying, wow, what they did with essentially a slide rule and a scratch pad is astounding. It really is astounding.
Of course, I wouldn't have learned any of this, or really anything about Surveyor, without the help of the Space Imagery Center and John. So I asked him to tell us a little bit more about the place he works.
The Space Imagery Center is a NASA-sponsored and funded regional planetary image facility. It's kind of a well-kept secret. And what we have is we have archive images of every mission that NASA has set off into space that have returned pictures.
That makes the Space Imagery Center valuable for research of all kinds, from studies involving the moon and its surface to videos like this one. For space nerds like me, it is the source of facts, images, and more than a few good stories. Places like the Space Imagery Center are vital not only for their role in preserving the scientific moments of history, but also as archives where the rest of us can visit places and times that we would otherwise not know about. In my case, it all started with a single word, Surveyor. Where would the Space Imagery Center take you? What questions would you ask? What stories would you hear? What word will start your journey? Think about it, because someday you might have a chance to visit a place like this and learn about a NASA program you have never heard of. Just like I did.
Hi everybody, I'm Matthew.
I'm Tasneem.
And I'm Grant, and thanks for watching the video.
Make sure you like and subscribe so you don't miss our live stream next week where we talk about the making of the video.
You can either ask questions live during the chat or you can put them below in the comments. Thanks.